photo taken in 1950. Two men talk, gentle smiles on their faces. Up until 5 years earlier, they were bitter enemies, fighting on opposite sides of a brutal war. Mitsuo Fuchida was the lead pilot in Japan's surprise attack on Pearl Harbor. He flew the first of 350 planes that sank four US warships.
On the battlefield, the more enemies you kill, the better your chance to get a medal. I'd lived all my life for that one day.
Jacob DeShazer, a corporal with the U.S. Army Air Force, was determined to take revenge. His plane dropped nearly 300 incendiary bombs on Nagoya in central Japan.
Jap, just wait and see what we'll do to you. You'll all be dead.
Years after the war ended, fate brought these two men together. Leaving the past behind, they forged a solid bond. Each became a devout Christian and traveled to each other's homeland. Fuchida to the US and DeShazer to Japan. Each encountered enduring hostility left by the war.
It brings me a memory that I used to hate. I used to hate them.
鬼畜米英に対する憎しみ、手ぶらで歩いてる進駐軍がおったら殺してやる。
Two men on a mission to overcome entrenched prejudice and hate. But first, they had to overcome feelings that burned within themselves. In this program, we shed light on the emotional journeys of two soldiers turned messengers of peace.
And how are you going to love a fellow like that? A mean, really a mean one.
What breeds hatred and how can it be conquered? Questions both men struggled to answer. Former fighters who reflected on their own deeds and spread a message of forgiveness. A journey of redemption from the past that resonates in today's world. Harbor, Hawaii. The stories of two soldiers, one Japanese and one American, begins here. December 7th, 1941. It was morning on a Sunday. World War II had erupted in Europe 2 years earlier. But the fighting seemed remote for many in America, which had stayed out of the war. The radio was carrying live coverage of a football game.
Still going, he's up to the 25, and now he's hit and hit hard about the 27-yard line. Bruiser Kennard made the tackle.
We interrupt this broadcast to bring you this important bulletin from the United Press. Flash, Washington. The White House announces Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor.
It is known. No, it is an unknown war.
The Japanese military had launched a surprise attack. Tora, Tora, Tora. The chief commander, Mitsuo Fuchida, sent these code words, signaling the strike's success. Eighteen days later, Fuchida presented this map to the Japanese emperor.
This is the original damage assessment report created by Fuchida for presentation to the emperor.
An American historian purchased this map in 2013 at an auction for $42,500. The red lines represent torpedoes, the red dots, bombs. The USS Arizona took 4 bombs and sank. It was extremely unusual for a commander to be granted an audience with the emperor. During his life, Fuchida wrote extensively, including a 2,000-page autobiography. He recounted how happy meeting with the emperor made him feel.
The emperor was in a good mood. Seeing His Majesty's satisfaction, I felt most honored, and tears of gratitude came to my eyes. It was more than any man could dream of.
Pearl Harbor killed more than 2,300 people. Among those seeking revenge was DeShazer, then a young U.S. Army Air Force corporal. He volunteered for a retaliatory campaign, the first U.S. air raid on the Japanese mainland. This footage shows the mission's 16 bombers taking off from a U.S. aircraft carrier in the Pacific in April 1942. DeShazer was a bombardier on one of the aircraft.
Japanese medals awarded United States officers for humanitarian aid to the Japanese people are returned attached to 500-pound bombs.
The planes would fly 1,200 kilometers to Japan, carrying just enough fuel to get there. After the raid, the men were to be rescued by China, then a US ally. It was a highly risky mission. The plane carrying DeShazer headed for Nagoya in central Japan. He dropped nearly 300 incendiary bombs on a fighter jet factory and gas storage tanks. DeShazer also turned his gun on civilians. This was not authorized under the mission. He shot and killed 5 workers at a military equipment plant. DeShazer later wrote about what drove him to target civilians.
I saw a small plume of black smoke. It smelled the same as the powder from the anti-air guns that were aimed at my plane. When you get hit, you want to hit back. I'd make the Japanese pay for the despicable attack they launched against my country, America.
The raid was completed, but 8 of the 80 crewmen were captured by the Japanese, including DeShazer. They had made an emergency landing inside Japanese-occupied territory in China. The Japanese filmed the Americans after their capture. Footage showing DeShazer under armed escort has also survived. The Americans were put on trial in Shanghai. 3 were executed for murdering Japanese elementary school students. The 5 who survived, including DeShazer, were given life sentences. Conditions in the Japanese prisoner of war camp were merciless. The men were confined to solitary cells infested with lice. They were fed soup with worms and just a few grains of rice. Interrogators resorted to physical abuse. Robert Height's cell was next to DeShazer's. They encouraged each other not to give in to despair.
And they would go put their head in the benjo so they could talk where the guards couldn't hear them. They would take an iron rod and they would put it behind his knees and they would jump on his thighs and that would separate his knees.
They seemed to be the very lowest type of people. It was the first time that I had ever been in such a wicked environment. My hatred for the Japanese almost drove me insane.
Mitsuo Fuchida had led the surprise attack on Pearl Harbor. In 1943, he was promoted to staff officer. The following year, he rose to become an air staff officer of the combined fleet. He strove to turn the war back to Japan's favor.
Our core aim was to kill, kill, kill as many Americans as possible. We wanted to murder them all and put America through hell until the very end.
On August 15th, 1945, Japan surrendered. Fuchida was called to testify before the International Military Tribunal on Japanese war crimes.
Please state your name and address.
生命住所を申し立ててください。
生命、内田光雄。
Fuchida was ousted from public service shortly after the war ended, and his soldier's pension was terminated. He had no source of income. In 1946, he returned to his hometown. Neighbors looked at him in a completely new light. The hero of the Pearl Harbor attack was now a militarist who had left Japan in ashes. The sudden shift pushed him to isolate himself. He built his own house on land from his in-laws. He dug a well and led a self-sufficient lifestyle.
Following the surrender, people started to point accusingly at professional soldiers like me. They criticized us, saying we willingly took Japan to war and destroyed the country. I hated all Japanese who despised me from the bottom of my heart. In my mind, I knew I shouldn't hate anyone. But I couldn't help how I felt.
Jiro Oka was Fuchida's junior at the Naval Academy. He still looked up to Fuchida like an older brother. The older man poured out his feelings.
Neighbors said people like him had caused the plight. Everything he'd believed was just was labeled unjust overnight. He really didn't know where to turn.
He was a Navy all his life till then. So he doesn't have a job. Unstable, that's one thing. And then all family were little and following him. And I think that made him a really traumatic change, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Then, in 1948, an American missionary arrived in Japan. It was Jacob DeShazer, the airman who'd been imprisoned by the Japanese. Just 3 years earlier, he had felt nothing but hatred toward the Japanese. Yet, here he was. For a year and a half after his capture, he was held prisoner at a camp in Nanjing. During that time, another member of the crew had died of dysentery. DeShazer and his fellow Americans held a simple funeral. There was a guard named Takeji Aota. He secretly gave the prisoners a Bible.
One of the prisoners died of disease. They wanted to give him a funeral. My father thought they'd need a Bible. He went to Nanjing City to find one and then gave it to them.
DeShazer didn't know what to make of the first gesture of kindness shown by a Japanese, but he accepted the gift. He had grown up in a Christian family, yet he'd barely read the Bible. He found himself devouring the pages. One verse in particular moved his heart. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. In this passage, Jesus refers to the Roman soldiers and Jews who sent him to the cross. It occurred to DeShazer that the Japanese, who treated the Americans so cruelly, didn't know what they were doing. He'd been defiant toward the Japanese guards, but now he decided to soften his approach. We found a tape recording in which DeShazer speaks of his change of heart. His daughter Carol has kept it all these years.
And how are you going to love a fellow like that? A mean, really a mean one. And you're supposed to love him.
Whenever DeShazer became angry, he forced himself to remember the Bible verse.
I went up the door and this guard came on duty. I put my face up there real close and I said, "Ohayou gozaimasu. Good morning, sir." And I smiled real big. And that guy looked real surprised. I had to put up with it for 6 days because every day I'd do something nice like that. And on the sixth morning of the sixth day, here he came on duty. He slid that door back and he had me in a nice boiled, juicy sweet potato.
And he said he could hardly eat the potato. It was so good. But he said he was thinking about it and it choked him up. He worked out his hatred and, you know, and how God had showed him that he had to show love when he, and it worked. He felt like it worked. I don't think my father could take all the hatred that he had and on his by himself.
After DeShazer was released, he studied theology at a U.S. college and became a missionary. Back then, the U.S. was promoting Christian teachings as part of its efforts to democratize Japan. It sent 3,000 clerics to the country. The first thing DeShazer did after arriving was to look for Aota, the guard who'd brought him the Bible. DeShazer wanted to express his gratitude for the kind act that had changed his life.
DeShazer searched for my father and was eager to see him. When my father heard this, he felt conflicting emotions. Post-war confusion still gripped Japan. There was a lot of talk about war criminals. I don't want to meet him. Dad said a part of him felt that way.
But they did meet. The reunion between former prisoner and former guard was awkward, but joyful. DeShazer established a small church in Nagoya, the city he'd bombed during the war. He traveled around Japan, spreading the gospel. He told people how his intense hatred for the Japanese had given way to forgiveness.
He slammed the door and caught my foot in the door jamb. I felt a lot of resentment towards that guard and bitterness. But I remember that it says, love your enemies and pray for them that persecute you. And to forgive that Japanese guard, I prayed for him and asked God to help him get to heaven someday.
Takashi Azuma was 18 when he heard DeShazer speak. At the time, he despised Americans so much, he wanted to kill them on sight. His father had died immediately after the war. He was riding a bike and was run over by a vehicle driven by US occupation forces. He wrote, "My father passed away, and we lost everything. We all spent our days crying."
We lost the war, and my father was killed by the victors. Drove me mad. The satanic Americans killed my father. I was filled with anger, hatred, and loneliness. If I saw unarmed occupation soldiers, I vowed to kill them.
Azuma was tormented by the feelings welling inside him, but he kept them to himself. When he heard that an American missionary was coming to his town, he had to get a look. The missionary was DeShazer. He spoke about how he'd had a change of heart toward the Japanese. Azuma was moved by his sincere words. He thought, this man might be able to understand my suffering, and plucked up the courage to approach.
He grasped my hand firmly. He was an ex-soldier, so there was nothing soft about him. It felt powerful. He said sorry, looking very sad. He said he understood how I felt. Being understood made me so glad. It's sad when no one understands. You feel very lonely. It felt like a door in my heart opened a crack. That's how you feel when you have someone to share your feelings with. My hatred began melting away that day.
Fuchida was still struggling with despair, triggered by Japan's defeat. But one day, something happened that dramatically changed his life. He'd gotten off the train and was on his way to US occupation headquarters for questioning. An American was there, handing out flyers about Christianity. Without thinking, Fuchida took one. It was titled, "I Was a Prisoner of Japan." DeShazer had written it. It told about how he overcame the fierce animosity he'd felt toward Japan since the attack on Pearl Harbor. Fuchida was himself experiencing uncontrollable rage. He immediately bought a copy of the Bible and read it during breaks from farm work over the next 2 months. He wrote down the phrase that moved him the most. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. They were the very same words that had moved DeShazer.
I went, ah, the them in forgive them includes me. As a soldier, I believed in war as a justified path to peace. I now realized my sins.
Fuchida decided to become a Christian. Jiro Oka was surprised by Fuchida's sudden transformation. Oka asked repeatedly what had happened to the dyed-in-the-wool servicemen.
Fuchida's pet phrase was, peace exists only under God. But peace was not his initial goal. He became a Christian to save himself. He desperately needed help. He couldn't go on living that way.
Fuchida immediately went to see DeShazer. This is footage of their encounter. DeShazer welcomed the lead pilot of the attack on Pearl Harbor into the Christian faith. Fuchida listened intently as DeShazer explained how he had conquered his hatred toward the Japanese.
I was ashamed of having chanted slogans to people such as, let's regain lost ground and perseverance prevails. I'd been fighting the war with a fiery hostility fueled by patriotism. But wasn't I being biased, narrow-minded, and self-righteous? I was ignorant. That's what led to tragedy.
Fuchida set out to become a missionary in the United States. His objective was twofold. One was to share his deep regret over the attack on Pearl Harbor. The other was to promote understanding between Japan and America, so wars caused by ignorance would never happen again. He traveled far and wide around the US. He marked the routes he took on this map. He took hardly any days off and delivered as many as 4 speeches in a day. This is a pamphlet from one of his talks. Highlighting his leading role at Pearl Harbor, he stood before the audience.
I am Mitsuo Fuchida, a former Japanese Navy chap who led the attack on Pearl Harbor. Today, I am very sorry for my action, but at that time, I was blind. DeShazer testified that he hated the Japanese. However, his heart was changed. This story inspired me. He has truly changed my bitter and sinful heart.
But he was taken aback by the fierce criticism he encountered. Mass murder. Mockery. Go back so we can breathe clean air again.
They were a bit afraid that he might be attacked by someone. They were careful about that and chose this place he should be in. And the hotel said they had night watch. It was a fearful thing, but he didn't show it when he spoke. He seemed very calm and sincere about everything he said.
Fuchida traveled to ground zero of American animosity toward Japan, Hawaii. He became determined to visit every local church, no matter how small. Inside the churches, no one spoke harshly to him, but he did receive many piercing looks. Juliet Kahi was at one of his speeches.
When I look at this, it reminds me. And now when I see his picture, it brings me a memory that I used to hate him.
She watched him struggle to reach out in spite of his poor English and people's critical looks, and she had a change of heart.
Your whole outlook changes.
He wanted to tell about what happened. They're going to hate you like, they're going to hate like him for so much, you know. When he professed what he did, he don't need to tell anymore. He did it already, pow.
A man who heard Fuchida talk said he felt very moved by his words.
And Captain Fuchida came in on the front, and he was introduced, and then he started speaking. I was sitting.
Jimmy Yagi is a third generation Japanese American. He was 6 years old when Japan struck Pearl Harbor. Other children bullied him, calling out Jap and enemy. Since that time, Yagi had cursed his heritage. He was in high school when he caught one of Fuchida's speeches by chance.
Ignorance breeds inconsideration. Inconsideration breeds hatred. And it's hatred that breeds war. I was ignorant about the world because of my patriotism.
The word ignorance struck a chord with Yagi. He'd been living with a conviction that the Japanese were evil personified.
I looked at him to see, first time in my life I saw the enemy. And when I first saw him, I looked, oh, he looks just like an ordinary man. In my mind, he was a oni. I was very reluctant. But I went up and I shook hands with him. But that began, I think, a change in my attitude toward the Japanese, which is my people, my heritage, which I never, but I always felt they were the enemy.
Fuchida and DeShazer continued their respective missions to stamp out hate. In 1970, DeShazer got troubling news. His son, John, then 21, had been drafted to fight in Vietnam. There he was exposed to Agent Orange, the defoliant sprayed by US forces. John developed diabetes and varicose veins after the war. Now 66, he still receives compensation from the US government.
I still have it. I had a blood vessel in here break inside, and I just about died from losing too much blood.
DeShazer was busy with his missionary work. He couldn't set aside one-on-one time for John, traumatized by Vietnam. Father and son both avoided talking about the war.
If you can talk to thousands of people, that's more important than talk to your son.
I didn't think so.
You don't think so? 1,000 people to make it to heaven is a lot more important than your child. But all he could do was pray the next day until God told him that the war was over.
People who knew DeShazer say what happened to John completely changed his father's views on war. DeShazer had been campaigning for peace since 1948 when he arrived in Japan, but in fact he had never renounced the concept of war. He believed the Pacific War fought by the US was just and had brought peace to the world. But anti-war sentiment now bubbled up inside him.
Unfortunately, the Vietnam War happened, and I think that was very sad for my father and my mother and the family and a lot of Americans. I think he had his feelings toward not wanting war probably became stronger during the Vietnam War.
At that time, the US and the Soviet Union were whipping up hostile feelings toward one another through proxy wars around the world. Can war ever be stopped? Is it meaningful to continually pray for peace? DeShazer wrestled with these questions. Someone who knew DeShazer says he could sense his frustration. Takahiko Aota is the son of DeShazer's wartime prison guard. He and DeShazer had become friends. Takahiko had gone to DeShazer's home for a visit. As they watched a newscast about the Vietnam War, Takahiko asked DeShazer a question.
Why doesn't war ever end? I posed that question to him. He kind of smiled and then started thinking with a faraway look. Finally, he said, I don't know. I remember that moment quite well.
At around this time, Fuchida was once again in the spotlight as the lead pilot in the attack on Pearl Harbor. A Japanese-American film called Tora 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 had been released. The movie dramatized the event, but used Fuchida's real name. The man who spearheaded the attack is now a devout Christian in real life. Fuchida was flooded with interview requests.
Do you feel now any regrets at what you did?
As a professional officer, I did not any regret. But since I became a Christian, I am now feeling very sorry.
Fuchida was frustrated. The message he was trying to send was about overcoming hatred. But it seemed everyone in America remained transfixed on Pearl Harbor. He wondered how he could get people to listen. A document that hints at Fuchida's state of mind survives. Gordon Prange was the chief historian of the Allied forces in Japan. He found Fuchida valuable as a research subject. Here's how his report on Fuchida begins.
Tighten your editorial seatbelt. My discovery could affect the Fuchida study adversely. We have a complicated personality on our hands in Fuchida. He is in many respects a fine human being and seriously devoted to the cause of Christ. But he's also weak. Make no mistake about it. He's been foolishly and cruelly deceptive. Fuchida has told 100 times that he seeks the truth. He wanted me to accept his words as gospel, and seemed to resent it if I seemed to check up on him.
Prange wrote that some of the stories Fuchida told were embellished. As an example, he recounted an episode from Fuchida's memoir.
A middle-aged woman came forward, leading, by the hand, a boy who looked about 12 years old. She said to me, "My husband was a gun commander on the USS Arizona. When you attacked Pearl Harbor, my husband died." That's when this boy was born. Please pray for my son. At a talk I gave about 10 years later, I was approached by an Army cadet. He said, "I am the boy you prayed for." The young man heard I would be giving a talk and came to see me.
Donald Goldstein had been Prange's research assistant. When he heard this story from Fuchida, he was touched and tried to identify the boy. He searched lists of war dead from Pearl Harbor and students at Army cadet academies, but no one matched Fuchida's description. Goldstein believes Fuchida created the story for a reason. He hoped that by telling a moving story, he might be able to draw people to his message of peace.
It was a parable, and that parable convinced you that I'm on the right track and you should follow. So I believe at the end he believed it. He is a product of his time. And he shows how bad war is, and he's trying to change it. One of the things that we have trouble in America is if you've never fought, you don't understand it. He did good things, made people feel better. Who would not have felt better had they not heard him? And that's good. That he saved people.
In 1967, Fuchida's 15-year-long mission in the U.S. came to an end. By that time, he had given 2,000 speeches. At the age of 64, he returned to Japan. In 1975, Fuchida and DeShazer were reunited for the first time in many years. It was during a TV talk show organized by a Christian group in the US.
I got that Bible finally, and I read the Bible clear through. I had it for 3 weeks.
Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
Two former soldiers with a self-imposed mission to break the chain of hatred. Two kindred spirits. By then, Fuchida's health was failing and he wasn't able to talk at length with DeShazer. That was the last time the two met. Six months later, Fuchida passed away at the age of 73. He was given a Christian funeral. His coffin was draped with a Japanese naval ensign. DeShazer attended the service. He said he couldn't help sobbing in front of everyone.
Well, I cried, really. And I thought, well, I'm going to see him in heaven. He's a brother.
The year after Fuchida died, DeShazer left Japan and returned to the US, ending 29 years of missionary work. He developed Parkinson's disease but continued to spread his message. After the 9/11 attacks, the US government launched a war on terror in the name of justice. DeShazer fervently called for peace and love.
God bless all of you.
While asking a family member about the date of his next appearance, DeShazer passed away. He was 95. Fuchida's daughter, Miyako, met an American and got married. The couple started a family in California. When Miyako announced her intention to wed a US Marine, her mother and relatives disapproved. Only her father supported her. Fuchida found special significance in bridging the world through marriage.
My father said, it's more mixed, it's better, because we understand each other better.
Complete, just intermixed, yeah. Like 100%, then you're all just human.
People close to Fuchida say he repeated these words right up until his death, the same words he shared in his speeches.
Ignorance breeds inconsideration. Inconsideration breeds hatred. And it's hatred that breeds the tragedy of war. We need to break the chain of hatred stemming from ignorance. That's the way to no more Pearl Harbors.